On this planet, there's a place where there are no houses, no big buildings, no police, no wages or salaries. The residents do not curse the authorities or give hell to new Russian oligarchs. In fact, they do not curse anybody. The place I'm talking about is located right in the middle of our country, on the Yenisei River in Siberia. People here rely only on themselves and expect performance only from themselves. Life in Bakta is geared to the cycles of nature and entirely depends on them. Every season brings new chores in the village, in the taiga, and on the river. At the end of May, logs drift down the Yenisei, trees cut down by moving ice in the upper reaches, and trees from timbering plants washed away by floods flow down the river into the ocean. They have only 2 or 3 days to catch the logs passing by the village. The locals have to do a lot of things during the brief summer, but the main thing is to manage to catch the log that they use for firewood. Of course, you can buy firewood, but then out of the 300 people in Bakta, only 50 hold down any kind of job. So for most of them, catching these stray logs is the simplest way to stock up on firewood for the winter.
Ну, дармовое. Попробуй это сейчас купи. Там, может, кубов 30 леса этого. А он стоит здесь 400 рублей, наверное, куб. Ну вот, пожалуйста, это вот несет на воде. Затянул. Распиливай, вези домой. Вот так живи всю зиму. Нет какого нет материка, никого не зависишь.
After pulling the logs out of the water, they leave them on the bank to dry. They're ready for sawing and splitting for firewood in 3 or 4 weeks. Summer. When they move to Siberia, the Russians usually settle along the river valleys. They settle down on the Yenisei in the same way as they had done earlier on the Dnieper, the Volga, and the Don. Life in a taiga village was not the same as in European Russia. They had to give up farming in favor of fishing and hunting. But the free use of the forest and the river, and being far away from the central government, meant that Siberians never experienced misery and poverty. Historically, the commercial trappers of sable have been a caste apart among hunters. They spend most of the year in the taiga, but in the summer, they spend most of the time working in the village. In the northern villages, there is no difference between life and work. In Bakta, a trapper is at the same time a carpenter, a tinker, a fitter, and a welder, also a farmer. The soil there is heavy with clay and rocks, but if you spread enough manure, it will support any crops.
Я первый раз посадил эти огурцы, их никто не садил. Отличные огурцы. Потом пошло. Малина. У меня малины были все волкокотой ограда, так вот до сюда. Это потом я сюда перетащил ее.
Картошку сажаю.
Но огурцы растут, помидоры растут, морковка растет, турня, репа, брюква. Все родится. Я не с родной матерью жил, я с мачехой жил. Вот она у меня садила эту капусту. Там вот такие, по 7 килограмм вилки были, 7500.
Vegetables grow quickly in spite of the short warm period. Bakta is less than 500 kilometers from the Arctic Circle. It has white nights for more than a month. That's why there's a lot of light and everything ripens.
Ну вот эти огурцы-то мы уж, наверное, третью неделю едим. Вот он, родимый, с пупырышками растет. Видишь какой? Какой сорт? Не знаю, но вкусный. Ранней весной мы тепличные едим, потом постепенно переходим на нормальные огурцы.
One thing they have never done here is growing cereal crops. There can be snowfalls at the end of May and even in June. The soil is damp and takes a long time to warm, and there isn't all that much land on which to grow crops. The taiga starts from the edge of the settlements. You have to go 1,000 kilometers south to see these crops. From there, grain is brought to Bakta up the Yenisei. In former times, it was the government's business to deliver wheat. Now this business is in private hands. This little boat starts at shuttle runs on the river and continues until it is covered with ice. It brings foodstuffs, mainly flour, grit, and canned food, to the northern settlements and villages. There is some demand for industrial goods, gas, and building materials, mainly bricks. They don't use bricks to build houses. They use them to build and repair chimneys. The chief of utilities himself procures bricks and personally escorts the cargo to Bakta. The Yenisei is the only link that Bakta has with the outside world. And that link is only available 4 months a year. For the rest of the year, there is one flight of the mail helicopter a week. The first call of the boat after winter is a great occasion for the locals. People order the goods they need and make shopping lists in the fall and give them to the captain, Ilya Fabrichenko. They have their orders filled 6 months later in early summer. The locals have modest demands, but then their incomes are also very modest. However, that doesn't turn your life in the village into misery, as it does in the city. If you work, you'll always have your loaf of bread or a piece of fish or meat, and you don't have to worry about any defaults or currency fluctuations. You can get by in Bakta without money, but you do need money to buy a new motor or fridge. Only a few people have jobs, or commercial trappers can afford such purchases. After working the vegetable garden, Anatoly Blume usually heads for the taiga, but he lingered this time to collect the washing machine he had ordered. In the early summer, the water level in the Yenisei and its tributaries is still not normal. Trappers take advantage of that and head for the taiga to inspect their properties while the timber is drying on the bank. Later, when the water level falls, it will be much more difficult to reach their trapping areas. Down here, every journey begins with the Yenisei. The river that links the north with the south divides Siberia into the western plain and the mountainous eastern part. Gennady Solovyov's hunting area is on the low left bank of the Yenisei, and Sergei Grebenchikov has his territory on the right hilly bank. The two of them meet briefly in the middle of the river, chat a while, share a drink of vodka before each goes his own way. Time is pressing. If they fail to make it before the water level falls, then the tributaries will have to drag the boat over land. Gennady Solovyov knows he needs his protective guards over his motor or even in the mainstream. Trappers have invented these contraptions made from steel rods and metal strips.
Быстрая река, мелкая, каменистая. Только защита спасает.
Русло не уследишь, выскочишь, ну и винт сломаешь, и шпонки сорвешь. И тебя может перевернуть. Потому что течение очень быстрое. Сразу тебя на мотор давление, можешь и ранец выломать у лодки. Так что с защитой обязательно надо ехать.
Лодку зала.
You can only make your way through such shallow water in a wooden boat. The boats referred to as wood by the trappers are made by old believers on the Yenisei. In spite of their size, these boats have a very shallow draft because of a flat bottom and a high transom. Every river in Siberia has its own character, and trappers each have their own way of handling it. When the water level is high, Sergei can go up this tributary in a simple motorboat, but only the first 15 kilometers from the mouth. There are no other ways except the rivers, so everyone tries to cover at least part of the journey over water. Beyond that, there's a steep rise and rapid after rapid. They're too much for a flat-bottom wooden boat, and Sergei stops here. Behind this wall, Sergei keeps another boat on the calm, deep waters. It can only be reached on foot, just 7 kilometers. For a trapper, 7 kilometers is no distance at all. In the fall, when Sergei will go trapping, the river will dry up. Then he'll have to walk all the way. And that's a trek through the forest over a distance of more than 50 kilometers. Left later than the others because of the washing machine. But the water level on his big river subsides more slowly, and he can go faster. It's a day's journey with stops to his area 150 kilometers away. For hunting. Encountering a beast by the riverside is a stroke of luck for any hunter. Still, Anatoly decides against shooting the animal. A taiga hunter always thinks twice before firing a shot. What's he going to do with his trophy? But most importantly, does he really need it today? But you can't keep the dog from indulging in its hunting instinct. A dog will never catch up with a deer when swimming. It can only do it in the forest. But in the forest, a clever dog will not chase it for long without its owner around. The one has to come on shore, but still, he has to make a stop. Anatoly travels light, taking only bread for food, and he catches fish for himself and his dog during the stops. The summer, even though you do not have the meat, is not the worst season. City folk may think that the hunter does nothing but shoot animals. The hunter in Siberia is the main protector of animals, but he is not a Greenpeace activist either. His love of nature has more solid roots because he lives with nature, and it is vital for him that animals, birds, and fish are in abundance. Otherwise, he cannot survive. It's not yet a grown taiman just to fry. The hunter will always know by the way his dog barks whether it's chasing a bird, a squirrel, or a sable, whether it's worthwhile picking it up.
Ну, молодец, молодец, нашел, да, нашел, нашел. Но рано еще, рано, рано его. Маленький он, не выходной еще, да, молодец. В начале октября, в середине, вот мы начнем ее добывать. А сейчас у него шкурка не выходная.
In summer, the sable's fur is short and sparse. Such fur is not valuable. By the summer, the sable will change its fur to make it marketable. Trapping will then begin. From here starts Evenki Land, the most sparsely populated area in the world. The average population density is one person per 50 square kilometers. In reality, there's not a single settlement or living soul through the whole length of the river. All the rivers here have Evenki names. Evenkia is larger than France. In this vast space, the Evenki used river systems for orientation. The terrain which they passed at least once was registered in the memories in the shape of a river map. So most of the place names are connected with rivers, and one in every two with fish. The Evenki name for grayling is Niru. This is a species of whitefish called Suri. Lenak or Siberian trout is called Maigu. Taimen is the king of Siberian rivers. It is Delhi in Evenki. It even has a mountain, Delimo, named after it, Taimen Mountain. Nikachen is the local perch. Pike is plentiful, so much so that it even has two names, Gutken, and the big pike is called Hakan in Evenki. You can catch a pike anywhere here by a variety of means at any time of the year. It is used to feed dogs, though in lean times it helps people to survive.
Экземпляр! Вот это кобыла, да?
At that point, the river grows shallow with a lot of rapids. The motor needs a guard. The first rapid was the easiest one, and Anatoly cleared it without much trouble. Ahead are four more, not to speak of sandbars and the like. The subarctic day in June lasts 20 hours. It is the sunset of the endless northern day when Anatoly reaches his property. The size of his area is 800 square kilometers. He has been exploring the taiga wilderness gradually for years. First, he builds huts. To make a hut in the summer, he prepares the logs in early spring. In April, thaws in the daytime and frost at night form a hard crust over the snow. It's a thick layer of ice. You can walk on it and even drive like on asphalt, and it's much easier to work. He has to bring the timber and make the frame of logs while the crust holds. That is all he can do toward building a hut in the spring. Work resumes when the snow melts, usually in early summer. Anatoly, assisted by his friend Mikhail, has built seven huts before, this being the eighth. And they only have a week to finish the job before the gnats appear. The mosquitoes are already here.
Вообще, я, честно говоря, комарам отношусь так это.
нормально, в принципе.
Когда в работе его шибко и не замечаешь, что комары.
They may be short of nails, but they always have wire in stock, which is an essential in their trade.
Вот они, гвоздюки. Ты их вот забиваешь, потом вот оставляешь такой кончик. Просто его раз завернул и все.
The locals have mixed feelings about technology. They respect things mechanical, but they do not want to depend on it. Machines break down. Delivery of spare parts takes ages. The hatchet is still the main tool, and everyone has a hatchet handy in the taiga.
Ну вот, окно в Европу.
Moss is a protection against frosts. Moss mixed with earth is used to make the lining between the logs and to cover the ceiling.
Мох и земля. Только в городах там какой-нибудь утеплитель специальный, а здесь вот утеплитель. Мох да земля. А делают обычно уже летом, когда весной лес натаскали. Вот. Уже в начале лета избушку срубили, вот ее покрыть надо, чтобы дождями сруб не промочило, чтобы он уже сох стоял, и чтобы к охоте уже избушечка готова была.
Заодно выкопаем погребушку, будем там хранить картошечку, лучок. Так, по голове мне, блин, в это время.
Later, new paths will be made towards the hut, and new traps will be set up, so there will be more chance to catch a sable. That is how the trapper develops his area year by year. This is the bigger part of his trade. Harvesting the animals is just the final part of the job. There is nothing else to do in the taiga. In summer, life moves to the village where other jobs are awaiting. The logs on the bank have dried by now. In Bakhta, the heating season, to use urban speak, turns into a heating year. It lasts from late August until the end of May, and it takes a lot of firewood. The harsh Siberian climate and the wild spaces certainly teach a man to survive alone. And this is not to say the Siberians despise teamwork. Teams have always been formed in the forest and on the river for mowing grass and making firewood. Homes and bathhouses are also built together. The team appeared in a perfectly natural way. It's nothing but mutual assistance, which is the core of peasant life. In a taiga village, kinship ties are stronger as the whole family is engaged in common work. Kids start to help with work early. At nine, a boy is a real workmate. They still work and play together. With the start of reforms, the locals didn't waste time in changing their lifestyle. They went back to planting potatoes and raising cattle.
Ну когда вот мы все коров завели, то это самое. Родители-то не держали же наши. Как-то все это в совхозе работали, а потом, когда вот перестройка началась, все, коров взяли. Все же почти одновременно. Такие сенокосные угодья пропадают, и косить некому. Раньше здесь совхоз все выкашивал, а частникам уж где достанется. А сейчас ни совхоз не косит, и частникам лень. Трудиться приходится, естественно, трудиться.
The locals don't welcome the hot July weather. They see it as a hindrance. The mosquitoes, flies and gnats have one collective name, gnus. But the most vicious of them is called moshka. It is out with sunrise and has a field day until dark.
Ну лепит. Прям лепит собака.
The bites are very painful. The moshka doesn't pierce the skin like a mosquito, but it eats little holes in it while administering anesthetic. A person only feels pain after the bite, after the moshka has sucked itself full of blood and flown away. Your whole body itches after that. The moshka crawls rather than flies. It penetrates under any clothing, into your boots, through the lacing in your boots, and even through holes in mosquito nets.
Тяжеловато. Сквозь сетки и то пролазит.
залазит, зараза такая. Чем плотнее ты одеты, тем оно вот это плотное место все издолбит, искусает до, вообще до мяса.
Вот теплые дни мошка где-нибудь в затишье невозможно заезд. Вот на ветерок хорошо рядом с домом.
The mashka attacks both people and animals.
Мошка разъела, сейчас дегтем рожу намажу. Нормально будет.
In Bakhta, people use birch tar against mashka. Creams and ointments help only for a short time, if at all. And they're costly. Tar you can get for free, and more importantly, its smell endures and doesn't wash off easily. To get tar, you need birch bast. It's stored up on the area where the trees are felled. In the winter, these birches will be cut down for firewood. Making tar from birch bast has been an ancient occupation in Russia. Only in the old days, they used a big clay pot instead of half a metal drum. You put a small pan in a hole in the ground and cover it with a sheet of iron with holes into which the tar will flow. The drum is turned upside down and earth is piled around the edges to make it airtight. The bast should smolder and not burn. Then it is surrounded with firewood and set alight. It takes about 3 hours to produce 300 grams of tar. Tar has always been used as a protection from rot. Its antiseptic qualities are good for treating wounds, and its sharp smell keeps the gnats away. Using straight tar is harmful. It has to be diluted.
Я где-то, допустим, на стакан дегтя, пол-литра почти рыбьего жира или там что такое, в общем, масло какое-нибудь. О, беги вечером в баню. Чумазый.
Собаки дегтем воняют, хозяева дегтем воняют.
While they go about their household chores, the trappers are preparing for the trapping season. The skis are the main means of transport in the taiga, and not only in winter.
Осенние лыжи делаются специально для осени, когда маленький снег, ходить по буреломам. Без лыж трудно ходить, потому что мох, по колено валишься в мох, потом в снег. А на маленьких лыжах хорошо ходить. И их для этого делают грубые.
The trapper must be sure that his skis won't fail him, so he makes the skis himself. Gennady Solovyov prepares the boards in the early spring. That's the best time for splitting the frozen spruce tree. He chips away a strip by driving wedges down the rings in the trunk. You choose the tree where these rings are not jagged, but even. Ski making continues in the summer when the chip dries. First they make the surface flat with an axe and then finish it with a jack plane. What makes this primitive and time-consuming method unique is that a ski chipped away along the ring is thin and light and remarkably strong. Both are important for the trapper. The plywood skis you buy in the store may be just as strong, but they're so heavy that after walking a while, you're unable to lift your foot.
Вроде совсем же тоненькая дощечка.
Вот. А если бы оно было не прямослойное, оно бы сразу же по слою сломалось.
The last stage is bending the ski tips. First, they are kept in hot water for about an hour. Then they are put in a clamp called bala. It's important to follow the foreman's directions.
И вот смотри, Кирилл. Вот давить не сюда надо, а давить надо вот сюда вот на лыжу, понял? И давить надо плавно, плавно, плавно давить, чтобы дерево привыкало. Видишь, оно идет как? Если резко начнешь, оно сощеляется.
Так, теперь бери вот эти вот, вот и медленно подымай. Подымай, подымай, подымай. Только это. Так, хорош. Еще чуть-чуть подыми. Лыжу не затясывают перед загибом. Ее затясывают, острые носки делают после загиба. Потому что если начнешь загибать, у тебя вот здесь вот, что носок вот здесь вот будет, а вот эти места лопнут. Вот так вот, вот получится. Вот. Вот. Понял?
After the tip is bent, the ski is tempered over a hot flame.
А она не разгибается потом. Но вот ее когда вот закалишь, ну, потом ей дашь немножко еще на бале постоять. И все, тогда она уже не будет совсем разгибаться.
The Yenisei tribes, the Ostyaks or Kets, have always excelled at making hunting gear, wooden vessels, boats and skis. But today, there are hardly any skillful hunters and fishermen left among them.
Лыжи делаю. Я уже да? Все согнул, все. Мне только руманка нету. Там я еще все сделаю.
Before the Russians came, the Ostyaks were nomads moving down the river in search of fish. Their way of life changed when the authorities made them harvest fur animals and pay the fur tax. The Ostyaks started to settle down in Russian camps when government stores appeared there. You could trade fur for vodka and get some flour on credit. And the Ostyaks are still in debt.
Что вы должны помните?
Да.
Иначе вы бы не давали тебя забывал.
Нет, конечно, только хлеб, а я вам больше ничего и не дам.
Да.
Две?
Две.
Пошли, давай.
Начинаем сюда с хлеба.
Курить-то надо. Спасибо, нет.
Пожалуйста.
Getting a credit is always a temptation, especially for credulous people and the innate poor resistance to alcohol and proneness to addiction have worsened their plight. The Ostyaks were head over ears in debt, but they couldn't wean themselves away from the stores, and they were fast losing their traditions and customs. Today, the Ostyaks will take any odd job, like mowing grass or making firewood. The Ostyaks chose not to grow vegetables or raise cattle like Russians. Allegedly, their faith forbids them to. They have only dim memories of their faith. The only reminders of the days of the shamans and the family cults are these figurines. They are called Owlas, the keepers of the family hearth. The Owlas sleep by day and at night wander around the nomadic tent, exorcising evil spirits and minding the fire. Daria Tiganova was the last woman who still had Owlas in her house. One night, her house caught fire. Most of the houses that ever caught fire in Bakhta belonged to Ostyaks and burnt down through sheer negligence.
Куклы нету, плохо. Ну, у меня дома нет, у меня сгорел. Горел, дом горел, и вещи куплены.
The Soviet government assumed tutelage over indigenous northern peoples. Children were plucked out of their families and placed in boarding schools as part of a sweeping literacy drive. When the boarding schools were shut down, it turned out that a whole generation of literate kids had lost the habits of living in the forest or by the river.
Старики у нас сейчас умерли. Сейчас наша молодежь тоже мало. И это. Раньше мы чучумы ставили, все, все, от них все учились. Сейчас мы немножко подбывали.
Олега.
Пьем, говорим, работаем.
Алеша.
Сейчас работы нет у нас.
Говоришь сразу.
Что?
Русские виноваты.
Нет.
Водяра бы не было бы.
Это мы сами. Сами. Могли бы это. Но есть люди, хорошо живут. Нормально. Хочешь, живи. И работай. А так как? Так никак. Без этого нельзя. А кто виноват, я не знаю даже. Тут трудный вопрос.
All Daria Tikhonova could salvage from the flames was a little home spirits. All the rest burned down. The Kets have always lived modestly, but poverty was unknown. Every poor man could come to a relative who was better off and stay with him. As for old folks, relatives took turns to take care of them. The Kets still have these features of the tribal system. Granny Dari was sent to a Ket village of Sulamai, where her elder daughter lived. There are more than 1,000 Kets on this earth. Perhaps they have survived because they still have a choice. Ket means man in translation. The whole life of Bakhtar residents revolves around the Yenisei, especially in the summer when it is the fishing season. Before the Bolshevik Revolution, fishing areas on the Yenisei were not assigned. A typical hamlet of 30 inhabitants would use the whole stretch of river up to the next hamlet. When the number of settlements was reduced, Bakhtar's population swelled. There's no longer enough room for them around the village, and they have to travel further away from it. But herding so many people together in one place, the authorities allowed them to fish only from the right bank, and the stretch of 30 miles was reduced to 4. When something runs counter to their way of life, even government laws and bans, the Bakhtar people tend to treat that as an odd misunderstanding. They think nothing of breaking these bans. They cast their nets where they spot constant fish shoals. The net is spread and dragged by the two ends over the bottom. The net with small cells is used to catch small fish. A single haul of the net gets you about a bucketful of tugun, a valuable and delicious variety of white fish formerly caught everywhere on the Yenisei. True, this is something that even people who live on the Yenisei do not always know, let alone the city folk. And the tugunes are sold only locally. Tugun is hardly ever salted. Tender and oily, it perishes quickly. It is either frozen or smoked. The best place to smoke the tugun is in a primitive bathhouse, where the stoves have no chimney.
Холод, допустим, дощатая коптилка.
Как бы конденсат.
Конденсат с улицы, ну, получается. А тут, понимаешь, опилки горят здесь, сухость, они одновременно, да, подсушивают. И они огнем не горят. Когда скоптятся, раз немного, щепочек бросишь, жару дал, чтобы так подварились слегка. Ну, это так, это, знаешь, для вкуса.
The Bakhtar residents are fish gourmets, but a smoked tugun is just to indulge the palate. Most of the fish they eat is freshly cooked.
Ну, а потом же, ну, что его на зиму, соленого? Ну, а что, а когда рыба есть круглый год, считай, ну, а зачем тугуна-то? Вот, пожалуйста, налима всяко разное поймаешь.
Ты знаешь, только отсюда у нас вывозили налима. У нас Туруханский район полностью работал на этот, на обеспечение в Казахстане этих городов, там, Байконура, этих. Самолетами возили, спецрейсами шуровали.
Все летело, а потом все летело в космос. От нас летела рыба, оттуда летели железяги.
Ан-12 придет, уцепит. Представляешь, полный самолет налима вверху.
Валера, давай эту в печку там закинь что-то.
Все заготовлено.
Да? Ну поджигай.
Только поджечь и все.
Поджигай.
Сейчас он костерчик распалится, опилки полностью зашумят. Все, дверь закрываешь, они уже без воздуха. А чтобы он не зачахло, вот так, видишь?
И воздух.
Поддув. Ну все, пора ускакать.
Ну.
Иначе сами будем как тугунчики.
All things smell the same here. They smell of campfire and fish. Fish on the Yenisei is more than food. The fishers in every camp have been catching fish for themselves and not for sale. There were no caps on the amount of fish caught.
Мы рыбачили здесь, ничего не запрещено не было. Ни тайменя, ни чир, ни сикки, ни омуль. Что им, какая рыба есть, все сдавали государству. И колхоз давал, и частники сдавали.
Рыбу надо ловить, и ловить всякую. Тем более люди здесь живут. Ну как это так? Что это значит? Я здесь живу на берегу Енисея и не имею права поймать ни стерлядку, ни осетришку. Это же ненормально.
The ban on fishing for sturgeon and sterlet is a sore topic in Bakhtang. The law is vague on formulating the ban. But when it was explained to the Bakhtang residents, it was in the toughest form. Now they go on catching sturgeon, but they're afraid. They keep a little for themselves while selling most of the fish and the caviar. Today, the state does not buy fish from the locals. It's considered unprofitable, but tourists from the cruise ships going down the Yenisei buy it up readily. It is practically the only source of income for the Bakhta people in the summer. They offer various fishes, but sturgeon and caviar are the most in demand. Sturgeon is the main commodity on the Yenisei, along with sable.
Стреляешь же?
Ситровая.
Почему? Пойдет, давай. Держись.
Хороший соленый, так что довезем.
А хороший.
Money in Bakhta is not critical, but it still plays a part in the local life. Everyone has a family and kids. You look at a flock of girls passing by, and you can roughly estimate how many sables or sturgeon fishes had to be sold to buy their clothing. Sturgeon fish are still called redfish on the Yenisei. In the old days, red meant fine or beautiful, but the method of catching it is anything but beautiful. A samalov or self-catcher is a thick long rope with corks attached as floats and sharp hooks. The corks hob on the water and attract the fish which runs into the hooks. First one, and then the next one, as it struggles to get free. You check the samalov every day to be able to pull up the fish while it is still alive. Sturgeon that are dead before they are pulled up are thrown away. They develop botulism faster than other fish and can get poisoned. The samalovs were banned before the revolution, and sturgeon were caught only by net. But when a total ban was imposed, the Yenisei people reverted to samalovs as the most suitable method for poaching. You throw it on the bottom, and no one can prove it is yours.
Воровать ездим. И будем ездить. Я такого мнения. Если меня поймают, я в протоколе так и напишу. Ловил и буду ловить рыбу.
Towards the fall, when sturgeon assemble over the pits in the bottom before the winter, the fish inspectors appear in Bakhtang. By the time they come in, there is no one on the river. It's hard to catch the locals red-handed. Not that fish inspectors are interested. All the people are poachers of necessity. The task of the fish inspectors is to lift the samalovs from the bottom and destroy them.
Вот подкрепление, видно, прошло третья лодка.
Samalov is an expensive toy, and the locals watch intensely to see whose is pulled out of the river. But more often than not, the inspectors simply collect the fish and leave the samalovs in place. The owners don't dare to check them until the raid is over. In the interim, a lot of fish get lost. You can't take dead fish, and those that escape are certain to die.
Смотрите, сколько ее подыхать на Яничей.
Сколько ее подыхат? Они приедут к Рыбнадзору, стоят здесь-ка. По неделе, по не стоят тут. А самолову стоят, они потом поедут, все уже прокиснет, там гоню, все выбрасывают.
Рыбу-то гробит.
What makes most of the people in Bakhtan elsewhere angry is the injustice of it all. In broad daylight, their traps are used to catch their fish by those who are supposed to protect it. And they talk about respect for the law.
Они у людей отбирают, а куда дают они? Куда дают? Раньше вот это отбирали у людей, так в садик сдавали, там, в школу сдавали. А сейчас они никуда не сдают, сами себе. Вот. Сами себе все делают.
When the people of Bakta fished sturgeon openly, they had a motive to protect them. The lawmaker was the village meeting, and nobody dared to break its rules because in the village there is no way of hiding things.
Раньше было совсем по-другому. Рыбнадзоров никаких не было, там сами все делали. Как только Ильин день подошел, все, выбирайте все самоловы. Вот так. Если только найду, поеду, сами выберут на бревнах. Изрубили и заказывают. Вот так. Ты лучше на яму не ходи. Пойдешь, а гобли получишь.
A remote northern village is a separate community. Throughout history, many attempts have been made to manage it. But custom has always proved stronger than law. Customs took shape over centuries, and only life could change them. Laws need to be enforced. The state cannot afford proper oversight, especially in Siberia. The nearest policeman is 150 miles away. And he is sure to be somebody's crony. The life of Bakhtar residents is like army service, with reveille and lights out and a fixed schedule. The schedule is fixed by nature itself, and everyone follows its course attentively. When the chipmunk begins to crack a cedar cone, it's a signal. First, that fall is around the corner, and second, that it's time to go gathering the nuts if you don't want the chipmunks and the birds to eat them all. The cones are recovered with the help of such a large stick called kolat.
Пойдем еще в ямку.
Подожди.
А мало шишки в этом году.
The cedar trees produce cones irregularly. Anatoly's interest in the amount of cedar cones in the forest has to do with his trade. It is a food for everyone in the winter, including the sable. The trappers can estimate from the numbers of cones whether it's going to be a good season for the trade. The cedar nut is useful in the household. It is sold and stored for the winter. Minced cones are taken to the village threshing floor, where strong Yenisei winds help to tuss the grains. The northern summer is short. You feel comfortable without a hat only in July. Today, the government is not interested in Siberian furs, fish, berries, and nuts, but it needs the votes of the Bakhtar residents. The government remembers about them regularly before the elections. It sends helicopters and boatloads of campaigners to Bakhtar.
Во-первых, Сулейман Казбулатович очень принципиальный человек. Ну вот, одно из первых положений, которое он сказал, что будет, если будет главой района, то будет финансовая проверка. Потому что достаточно много нарушений в этом плане, и не все прозрачно.
Bakhtar residents like elections. The campaigners always bring necessary goods. This time around they brought flour, and flour is good. And the youth can attend a free concert. In short, bread and circuses. Democracy. Yeah.
большая, здесь сердце края, на Енисее город Красная.
As for voting, Bakhtar residents don't care who they're voting for. Self-reliance has long become the rule. It's common knowledge that the government can let a person down. Freedom-loving and strong people have been moving east from ancient times. They passed steppes, mountains and ice and settled down, strengthening a large chunk of the earth. What these people needed, they took themselves. Freedom and the art of survival, boundless spaces and the habit to overcome them gave the Siberian a sense of being the master of his land. Not an owner of a patch of land, but a master of these skies, this water, and this land.